Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Vishnu Sahasranam playlist. We are back, a bit late, but back on time again. So today we shall continue with the next series of shlokas. And here the great disciple of Maharishi Vyas, Vaishampayana, starts speaking. He doesn't speak much. And then Yudhishthir Maharaj starts speaking, and then Bhishma Pitama starts speaking. Alright, so many interesting personalities we will discuss during these verses, okay? And not many personalities, I would say. There are many, but we won't discuss them. We will discuss primarily on this verse, which these two verses which Yudhishthir Maharaj asks, okay? That will be our primary focus. So, and after this video, Shri Bhishma Vacha, Bhishma Pitama will start answering the questions, okay? But before answering the questions, before knowing the answers, we must know the questions. Because many times we just know all the answers, but in Kali Yuga people, they think they have all the answers to all the questions, but how many of them actually know to ask the right questions? So therefore, it's crucial that we not only know the answers, but we also know the right questions. All right. So these questions consist of such queries from any religious practice, basically any spiritual path, by which we can actually improve our life and we can radically transform our life. All right. So therefore, these questions are very crucial. So let us start. And before this, we had where we discussed in the previous verse that regarding, what was that? Yeah, yasya smarana matrena janma samsara bandhana vimuchyate namastasmai vishnave prabhu vishnave. I bow down before all powerful Lord Vishnu, the mere thought of whom releases one forever from the ties of birth and death. I bow down before all-powerful Vishnu. Alright, so therefore, now, Sri Vaishampayana Uvacha. Alright, and as usual, if you have not watched the other videos in this playlist, then please watch them. Otherwise, you may be clueless of what we are discussing here. And if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, then please go down to my website down in the description section. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. Shri Vaishampayana Vacha Shrutva Dharmana Sheshena Pavanani Cha Sarvacha Yudhishthira Shantanavam Punar Eva Bhavasata. So what is this, who is this Vaishampayana actually? Shri Vaishampayana Uvacha. Also Vaishampayana is one of the very famous disciples of Maharishi Vyas actually. So, so he is a disciple of Maharishi Ved Vyas, and he has, Vyasdev has many other disciples. Sukadeva Goswami is his son and disciple. Then Jayamini Rishi, and then Janmejaya was the one who had narrated the entire Mahabharata. King Janmejaya. Janmejaya is the son of Parikshit Maharaj, and Parikshit is the son of Abhimanyu, and Abhimanyu is the son of Arjun and Subhadra. So, therefore, Vaishampayana, he is one of the great disciples of Vyasdev, and he is now describing about Yudhishthir Maharaj here. Shrutva Dharmana Sheshena. After hearing the description of all rules of religion, Pavana Nija Sarvasha, and all purifying places of pilgrimage, Yudhishthira Shanta Navam, Yudhishthira gained, Yudhishthira inquired from Bhishma, Punareva Bhavasata, the son of Maharaj Shantanu. So Yudhishthiraha means Yudhishthira Maharaj is doing something, he's in the limelight. Shantanavam. Who is this Shantanavam? Or what is Shantanavam? Shantanavam means son of Maharaj Shantanu. Okay? And Punareva means he has again gone and asked, because Bhishma was lying in the arrow bed and Krishna had instructed Yudhishthir to go and ask to Bhishma regarding what the secrets of dharma and spirituality and how to be a good person, what is good conduct, what should you do in life, what you should not do. All right, so Krishna had actually instructed Yudhishthir to go and inquire from Bhishma, and then Yudhishthir decided to go and inquire. Okay, so let's go to the next verse. And yeah, before going, we know about Shantanu Maharaj. He's the father of Bhishma Pitama, and Bhishma is the son of Shantanu and Mother Ganga herself. So Shantanu Maharaj and Ganga had married, and then Bhishma was born, and then later on Ganga Devi took him to the heavens and to the higher planetary realms above Bhuloka, and then she trained him under many formidable gurus, you know, like Brihaspati, who is the guru of the Devatas. Then we have Shukracharya, who is the guru of the Daityas. You know, can you imagine a person who has taught, who has been taught by both Daitya Guru and Dev Guru, how knowledgeable he will be? So these two personalities, then Parshuram was like his martial teacher, his prime guru. Okay, and therefore Bhishma is also known as Parshuram Shishya, means the disciple of Parshuram. And apart from that, he had also learned from Markandeya and so many other great personalities, all the great divine sages he had learned from Kashyap, then from so many great personalities actually. Right, so and then Ganga Devi had returned Bhishma, and that time his name was Devrat. And when he took that formidable vow that I will never marry, and I will always remain a brahmachari, and I will always protect the throne of Hastinapur as if my father is sitting there. Okay, so when he took the vow of celibacy, the devatas from the sky, from the heavens, they started throwing flowers, and this name started reverberating in the entire universe. They started chanting Bhishma, Bhishma, Bhishma. What is the meaning of the word Bhishma? The word Bhishma has many meanings actually. One of the meanings is something which is very grave, something which is very heavy, something which is very big, something which is massive, something which is huge. So Bhishma is one who had taken that grand oath, the one who took that huge oath. But now somebody may think, there was a person who had asked a question once that, okay, Bhishma had taken a vow of celibacy that he won't marry and he would stay lifelong as a celibate. But there have been many people who have taken the vow of celibacy. They have already taken it. So, but we generally don't see that when somebody decides to not marry and dedicate his or her life to spirituality. You know, we don't see devatas coming and throwing flowers. You know, and they don't chant Bhishma, Bhishma, Bhishma. But in his case, why did the devatas came and all the celestials, they cheered and they geared him up. And why did they appreciate him so much? Why? The reason is because generally when somebody doesn't marry, they don't stay in the home. They go out to the forest and they stay there, or they go and stay in a temple under a guru as a brahmachari, and later on they become a sannyasi. A sannyasi is supposed to travel the world preaching spiritual knowledge. There are four levels of sannyas actually: Kutichak, Bahujak, Bahudak, Parivrajikacharya and Paramhamsa. These are four levels actually. So generally a sannyasi preaches, okay, the spiritual knowledge in the entire world. But sometimes the sannyasis stay at one place, and they also go into secluded meditation, like they have these bhajan kutis in Vrindavan, where they want to spend the rest of their life practicing spiritual path exclusively, not having contact with anybody. Okay, so there are sannyasis like this also, or there are sannyasis who travel around the whole world. They keep spreading spiritual knowledge. So there are sannyasis of different kind basically. Parivrajakacharya is one who keeps traveling. Okay, So the thing is, there are many personalities like this who have taken into a who have taken to a spiritual path very seriously, but nobody is known as Bhishma. Why this personality, Devrat, son of Shantanu and Ganga, is only known as Bhishma? Why? Because, as I said, most of the people taking vows of celibacy, they go, they don't stay at their home and practice celibacy, okay? Because the home is generally a center for materialistic activities. You know, there are men, there are women, there are children, there are parents, and there are uncle, aunt, all these things keep happening. So materialistic activities are always in the limelight unless the family is very much spiritually elevated or awakened or cultivated, okay? Which doesn't happen in 95% of the cases. So in that case, now in case of Bhishma, if you see this Bhishma, or the one and only Bhishma, you can say. He, the devatas knew that he had to stay within the palace, and in the palace there are so many allurements. You know, you have the best of the food. You know, it is not like the food which you get in the ashram. You know, very simple sattvic food which you get in ashram or in spiritual communities. But you know, the food which is there in the royal palaces, imagine, you know, such palatable food, and it's very difficult to control the senses after one eats such nice palatable food, because if the food has too much rajas, because they say the tongue, the belly and the genitals, they are in one line, okay? So if somebody cannot control the food which they are eating, they cannot control their belly, and then they cannot control their genitals, okay? So their semen will flow downwards, and when that starts to happen, then the person cannot follow celibacy. So celibacy means they are following urdhva retas. Urdhva retas means the semen is flowing upwards actually, okay? So that's known as urdhva retas. They are preserving the semen, and gradually the semen starts flowing upwards actually. So therefore, Bhishma, he stayed in the palace. Imagine, you know, with all these beautiful, like a sannyasi or a brahmachari's life is very austere, it's very simple, and it's like very minimalistic. But imagine his life in a royal palace, okay? Full of comforts, luxuries, and he had all the power and all the opulences. It's very difficult to be detached when you have so many opulences actually. It is easier to be detached when you are living in an ashram actually, because then you don't possess anything, so it's easier to stay away from it. And then royal palace means there are so many members of the opposite sex also, so many beautiful ladies, so many kings and queens and families, and you know, so much royalty, so much opulence. So amidst of all this, to stay as a celibate, it is next to impossible. Only he can do that, and that is why he is known as Bhishma, right? So therefore, this is very crucial that we understand why he is known as Bhishma, okay? Because not just because he is a celibate, but he was a celibate inside the royal family, which is it's next to impossible, okay? So then Shantanu, yes, and he was the son of Shantanu and Ma Ganga. And then when Shantanu left this planet, and then Bhishma had taken care of this Chitrangad had died because of fighting with another celestial heavenly being whose name was also Chitrangad. And then there was Vichitravirya also did not live much long. Okay. So then the long story of the Mahabharata continues like this. So Shantanavam. So therefore, Shantanu's reference is there here. And Shantanu is also a very great personality originally, because when he heard that my son has sacrificed his whole marriage for just my pleasure so that I can get married to Satyavati, therefore, my dear son, I bless you that till the time you don't desire, death personified will not come near you. You won't die till you want. Okay. You'll get the boon of Ichha Mrityu, which means you can die whenever you want. Okay, until the time you don't want, you will be alive. Okay, Punareva Bhivasata. Okay, so now, then let us go to the next verse. And then here, Yudhishthir Maharaj is going to ask the questions. Okay, so there you go. Yudhishthira Uvacha. किमेकं दैवतं लोके किंवापेकं परायणं स्तुवन्तः कं कं अच्यन्त प्राप्नि उर्माणमाशुभम्. ओके, किमेकं दैवतं लोके किंवापेकं परायणं. सी किम किम किम, दिस वर्ड किम इज द किम मींस व्हाट, हु, हुम, इट्स ऑल डब्ल्यू. ओके, स्तुवन्तः कं कं अच्यन्त प्राप्नि उर्माणमाशुभम्. Okay. Yudhishthira said, please tell me who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Kime kam daivatam loke, the ultimate controller of the entire universe. Devatam loke, kim vap ekam parayanam, who is the ultimate destination of all beings. Okay. Stuvanta kam kam archantam, archantam, stuvanta and archan, these two words are very significant. Stuvan means to do stuti. Stuti means to glorify somebody. Okay, stuti means praise basically. So that's why there's this thing called as stuti gan, which means you are praising somebody basically. Okay, so there is different types of stutis actually. There is Vishnu stuti, there is Rudra stuti is also there, you know? Then Durga stuti is there. So stuti is basically a praise. Even if you are praising somebody, it's like you are doing stuti for that person. Okay, so therefore Yudhishthira is asking actually, who is that personality whose stuti I should do? Who is that person who I should praise? Okay, stuvanta kam kam archantam. Very good. Archantam, the word archan means to worship actually. Okay, so archana means to do puja. So whose puja should I do? Okay, whose stuti should I do? Whose puja should I do? Okay, prapni urma nama shubham. Okay, and prapni ur means to obtain. Okay, manava means human beings, shubham means all auspiciousness. So, so Yudhishthir is asking, who should I glorify? Whose stuti should I do? And who should I worship? Whose archan should I do for gaining all auspiciousness? Okay, so these are very beautiful questions which he has asked. Kime kam devatam loke, who is the devata of all the lokas? Okay, please tell me who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the ultimate controller of the universe. Kim vap ekam parayanam, okay, who is the ultimate destination of all living beings? Okay, so very beautiful questions. Then the next shloka is, ho dharma sarva dharmana bhavata paramo matah kim japan muchyate jantur janma samsara bandhanat. Very beautiful question. Okay, ko dharma sarva dharmana, what do you consider the best of all religious processes? Bhavata paramo matah, paramo matah, what mantra? Kim japan muchyate jantur, what mantra should one chant to become free from the bondage of repeated birth and death? Janma samsara bandhanat. Yeah. So he is asking here, ko dharma sarva dharmanam, which is the topmost of all religious practices. Okay, and then he is asking bhavata paramo mataha. So here you can find reference to you can relate to many different scriptural verses. When this is the best way to read and understand the scriptures actually. So when you hear a particular shloka quoted here, then you should immediately think where else, which other scripture is there a similar shloka like this. By that you can connect the dots actually. Okay, so for example here he's asking, ko dharma sarva dharmanam bhavata paramo mataha. So So there's a similar like this question is which is the best of all religious process. So Lord Shiva also says this to Mother Parvati. It's a very beautiful shloka. He says, "Aladhanam api sarvesham Vishnu aladhanam param tasmat paratalam devi tadyanam samarachanam." So he says, "Aladhanam api sarvesham." Aladhana means the word aladhana means to worship. Okay, so here you saw there was one word. Stuvanta kam kam archantam. Okay, archantam is to do archana. It is archana is directly related to puja, the vidhi puja which we do. And aradhana means worship in general. And archan is a part of aradhana actually. Okay, archana is a part of aradhana, you could say. So there, Lord Shiva says, aradhanam api sarvesham. Among all the worships, Vishnu aradhanam param. Worship of Lord Vishnu is the topmost. It is supreme. And then he says, tasmat parataram devi. But there is one thing which is even better than worshipping Lord Vishnu. Tadya naam samarachanam. What does this mean? Tadya means paraphernalia, which means Lord Vishnu's devotees. Tadya naam samarachanam means worshipping his devotees is higher than even higher than worshipping Lord Vishnu also. Okay, so this is something similar which came to my mind regarding this shloka. Okay, so now this shloka, Lord Shiva's statement is sometimes misrepresented, misquoted, misunderstood. So when he says worship of Vishnu's devotee is higher than worshipping Vishnu, he doesn't mean to say you do not worship Vishnu. Okay, so suppose like Lord Ram, Vishnu, Krishna, Vishnu or Ram, they're all the same. But suppose you take Lord Ram's case. So then you have Hanuman. So then suppose you independently go and worship Hanuman ji. Okay, that is not very good, because you should not know, we should never actually worship Lord Vishnu's devotees independent of him. Okay, so the best thing, if somebody is a devotee of Hanuman ji, the best thing to do is to glorify him in connection with Lord Ram. Okay, and many many people in India, they read Hanuman Chalisa. So even in the Hanuman Chalisa, if you see, it is all a praise of the Ramayana basically. Yes, Anta Kala Raghuvar Pur Jai Yaha Janma Hari Bhakta Kahai. So it means you are eternally a servant of Lord Ram. So that is an example of glorifying Vishnu's devotee in connection to Lord Vishnu himself. Okay, so then we have the example of Prahlad Maharaj. Prahlad Maharaj, we get to know him from the seventh canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Seventh canto, yes, of course. So there he's always glorified, but not independently. He's not like, oh, some independent king Prahlad, he's doing some big stuff. No, he's not like. He's always glorified in relation to Lord Narsingh. Okay, so therefore, whenever you glorify any devotee of Vishnu, you take Sudama, he's Krishna's great friend, for example. So Sudama is never glorified independently. Oh, Sudama was some great personality. I mean, of course, he was a very great personality. That's why he was Krishna's friend. But when you talk of Sudama, you must talk of Krishna. Okay. Similarly, Yudhishthir. Similarly, Arjun. Similarly, Bhim. Similarly, Nakul. Similarly, Sahadev. Similarly, Kunti. Similarly, Draupadi. Okay. So the scriptures never glorify. You will never hear they will glorify Kunti. Oh, she was a great lady. Blah blah blah. She did this. She did that. That and all is fine. She was a very great lady, but she is always glorified in relation to Lord Krishna. Okay, why? Because Krishna was her nephew. That was the reason. No, that's not the reason. The reason is because she was a great devotee of Krishna. Okay, and Arjuna also, he was a great devotee of Krishna. That is why he is always glorified. And even if you see the Bhagavad Gita here, sometimes Westerners who are not much aware of the Bhagavad Gita, if you see this here, if you see, sometimes, oh, in this photo, Krishna is standing. Okay, but generally, Krishna is sitting here. Okay, here. Generally, he's sitting here. Today, he's standing here. Generally, he's sitting somewhere here, and Arjuna is standing here, okay, and he's fighting. So, therefore, most of the times you will see that Krishna's devotees are more in limelight than him himself. Okay. Yeah, that's how it is actually. And therefore, whenever we glorify a great personality, it has to be in relation to Vishnu. That glorification has to be in relation to Vishnu. Okay. Otherwise, independently, we should not glorify somebody. Okay. We can do that. There is no harm in that. But it is good if we do that in relation to Lord Vishnu. Okay. So, and then he's asking, Kim Japan Muchate Jantu Janma Samsara Vandana. This is very interesting here. He's asking, whose japa should I do? Which mantra should I chant to become free from the bondage of repeated birth and death? Okay. So, I mean, there are many things which he could have asked, but why does he ask about mantras? Why does he ask about japa? Because in Kali Yuga, the Yuga Dharma for Kali Yuga is japa, Harinam Sankirtan, which means chanting the names of Lord Vishnu. That is the Yuga Dharma for Kali Yuga. So in Satyuga, the Yuga Dharma was meditation, where you would sit and meditate on the Vishnu form in your heart. But in Kali Yuga, but in Satyuga, that people's lifespan was very long, you know, hundreds and lakhs and millions of years. So they could do that. And they had a very higher level of sattva within them and within the society also. So for them, that was the process. But in Kali Yuga, you try to close your eyes and you just try to meditate. It doesn't work. It's very difficult because our mind is always disturbed. Kali Yuga means Manda Sumanda Matayo, as the Bhagavatam says. Manda Bhagya Upadrita. Their mind is always disturbed. Some anxiety or some depression is always there. You see yourself or anybody or see everybody in general. They are never happy. Very few times will you see when people, they will admit that, oh yeah, I'm happy, you know, God has given me everything actually. So that doesn't happen in Kali Yuga. Okay? Very rarely that happens. So then in Treta Yuga, it was doing yagyas, okay, all these fire yagyas and these Brahmins and Rishis and Munis chanting mantras and giving oblations to fire. Then Dwapar Yuga came. Dwapar Yuga, it was worshipping the deities, Archa Vigraha. Okay? And then in Kali Yuga, it is Harinam Sankirtan, which is the easiest way to chant the names of Lord Vishnu. And even Srimad Bhagavatam also says this at the end. Nama Sankirtanam Yasya Sarva Papa Pranashanam Pranamo Dukkha Samanas Tom Namami Harim Param. So, and Parikshit Maharaj, Sukhdev Goswami also says something very similar to Parikshit. He says, Kaler Doshani Dheerajan Asti Hiye Kan Mahat Gunar Kirtana Deva Krishnasya Mukta Sangha Param Vrajet. He says that Kaler Dosha Nidhe Rajan, oh great king Parikshit. Kaler Dosha Nidhe Rajan means Kali Yuga is an ocean of faults. You will see people finding faults with each other. 24 hours they are doing that. Okay. They are faulty themselves and they are finding faults in others also. Kaler Dosha Nidhe Rajan Asti Hi Ekan Mahat Gunan. But there is one Mahat Gunan, means great quality. What is that? Kirtana Deva Krishnasya Mukta Sangha Param Vrajet. One who does Kirtan of Krishna, Mukta Sangha Param Vrajet, he gets ultimate liberation. Okay. So these are the things which are actually leading to this Vishnu Sahasranam. Okay. So these are the different similarities which I gave you from different scriptures, different texts from Srimad Bhagavatam and from what Lord Shiva says. Okay. So therefore, whenever you are reading the scriptures, you should understand why a particular thing has been said and why it has been asked. So, Yudhishthira Maharaj, why does he ask, Kim Japan Muchate Jantur Janma Samsara Bandhana? Why does he ask, whose japa should I do? Because he knew that Kali Yuga is coming. In Kali Yuga, chanting the name of God is the authorized bona fide process. Okay, so that is why he's asking this, so that when Bhishma answers, then everybody knows what to do in Kali Yuga. All right, so that is it from my side, and in the next four words we will start. Sri Bhishma Vacha Jagat Prabhum Deva Devam Anantam Purushottamam Stuvan Nama Sahasrena Purushas Satatottitaha. Okay, so Now, Bhishma Pitama will start speaking the Vishnu Sahasranam, okay, and from there it will actually start, all right. So, stay tuned for the next video, and therefore, ask the right questions like Yudhishthir Maharaj is asking, all right. There you go. If you're new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding your horoscope, then you can always do it via my website down in the description section. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will find Him.